Hello everyone, and welcome back. Today we are going to be building Endbots 3-pound horizontal spinner, Vector. In order to complete Vector, we will need a few extra items, including a transmitter and receiver, a drive ESC, which we recommend our Endbots DESC, a 3 or 4 cell LiPo, a 450 milliamp battery is what we recommend, there's a link on the product page, a battery charger, wire, heat shrink, and green Loctite. And then for tools, you need a soldering iron and some solder, wire strippers, needle nose pliers, or a twist hub key. So let's get started. So the first thing that we're going to do is disassemble the gearbox and apply Loctite to the screws that hold the gearbox to the motor. To do this, I'm going to use Loctite 638, which I like because it holds better than the blue Loctite, but it's not as hard to remove as the red Loctite. So to disassemble the gearbox, all there are two screws. Just undo them and set it aside. And then there's two more screws, which I'll remove one at a time. And I have a little puddle of Loctite there. And I just dip the screws in and then screw them back in place. So with Loctite, a little does go a long way, so there's no need to douse the screws completely. I'm just going to go ahead and put this gearbox back together. And I'm going to go ahead and Loctite the ends of these screws while I'm at it, just so that the whole thing, there's no way it can come apart. Repeat this process with the other gearbox, and then we'll move on to the next step. Let's go ahead and build a 3D printed side mount next. So go ahead and insert the GA25 motor, rotate it so that the screw holes align, and then insert the small metric screws. You're going to want to use the longer of the two small Allen keys for this because the other one is imperial and this one's metric. If you use the wrong one, you might strip them out. So now that that's attached and the motor is secured, the next part's to put in the snap hub. Now the best way to line this up is to have the shaft sticking out just a little bit and then tighten the set screw with the Allen key. You don't have to worry about where the flat is because the set screw doesn't touch it. Now that that's secured to the motor shaft, we're going to go ahead and add our wheel. The wheel that we're using is a 2-inch by 3/4-inch wheel, although a 1 3/4-inch wheel would also work. Now to attach it, we're just going to go ahead and use these pliers, push it in while holding the wheel, and twist until it pops. Now we'll just make sure that the wheel is spinning freely, and we can move on to the next step, which is adding the aluminum side guards. These just get put in with 4 button head screws, tighten them all down, and we are good to go. The last thing that we need to do to the module is add wires to the motors. Now, a good rule of thumb is to go ahead and make your wires the same width as the frame. So once you get the wire cut, you're going to want to strip the insulation off the end of the wires and tin them. Now, when you tin the wires, all you're doing is you hold the soldering iron up against the wire for a second, and you just touch it with the solder, and that lets the solder flow around the wire, which makes for an easier connection. Now, I've already tinned the tabs on here, and you always want to tin both sides, because then all you have to do to connect them is just touch the soldering iron to one side, and dip the other side in there, and then remove the soldering iron, and hold on to it for a split second longer, and then you're good. Once you complete one module, go ahead and complete the other one, and we'll move on to the next step. So let's go ahead and mount the motor modules to the base plate. The base plate's the one that has the brushless motor mounted to it, which we'll do later. So go ahead and run 3 screws in per side. Doesn't matter which side you do first, as they're interchangeable. You may notice there's a couple extra holes on this one, and that's because it's a first generation kit. After testing, I decided to move the mounting holes a little bit further out to increase the strength of the base plate. So now that we have the motor modules attached to the base plate, let's move on to the brushless motor and speed controller. So I'm just going to go ahead and snip off the bullet connectors here right at the very edge and pull off the bit of insulation on there. The reason that I'm doing it this way is that I want to have as much of the wire as possible. So now that I have all the wires cut, make sure they're about the same length, and I'll just pull off the end of the insulation here. With silicone wire, it's very easy to strip the insulation off, which is one of the reasons I prefer it over PVC. So now I'm going to go ahead and tin the pads on the brushless ESC. Okay, so now it's time to tin the pads. So all I'm going to do is I'm going to take my iron and hold it up against the pad and then touch the solder to it. When it starts to flow, I'll make a nice little puddle, move on to the next one. The pads on this speed controller are pretty small, but they tin quite nicely. Now I'm going to tin the wires. One thing to note about the ESC is that it is basically a big heat sink, and so it does take quite a bit of heat to actually tin it. And so if your iron is a little weaker than mine, it may take, you know, 15 seconds or so, but it shouldn't take too much longer than that. Now I'm just going to go ahead and attach these wires, and all I'm going to do is rest the iron over the wire, over the pad, and as soon as they melt, I'll hold it for a few seconds, and then, I guess I'm going to trim the wire first. So once I do that, there we go, focus. There we go. Okay. So, now what I'm going to do is just touch the wire, get the wire a little warm, touch the pad, touch the wire to the pad. As soon as it melts, let go. And now I'm going to do the same here. Now, it does matter what order you get the wires in. One way will have it spinning clockwise, and one will have it spinning counterclockwise. This can be changed in the software, so I'm not really worried about which way it is. If you don't want to change it in software, just connect the wires and then test it, and then you can swap it back from there if you need to, and you just switch one pair of wires. So now that that's connected, I'm going to go ahead and put the motor ring on. And you want to make sure that the big flat side is facing towards the top and the narrow side is facing towards the bottom. And just push it on there. It does take a bit of force, but it's not too bad. And you want the top face of the pulley to be aligned with the top, not the top of the motor, but the top edge of where the cutout is. So about like it is now. So like that face to that face. This can take a little bit of adjustment back and forth, but eventually you'll get it. And it's okay if it slides a little bit, because this kind of clutches on big hits. So now we're going to go ahead and mount this to the plate. So now all we have to do is line up the motor so that the wires are pointing the correct direction. And put the small flatheads in. They're the same as the ones that mount the GA25 motors. So you'll be using the long Allen key for this one. Go ahead and cinch these down nice and tight. And then we're ready to mount the ESC where it goes and mount the back plate as well. Next, we'll be installing the brushed ESC. The brushed ESC we're going to be using is the DESC with the FR Sky receiver attached to it. And I've already wired in this little connector here, which is just to make my life a little easier. It connects directly to the brushless ESC. And the reason that I do it that way is so that you can program the brushless ESC and not have to worry about, changing the connectors each time. So now I'm also going to be using a FingerTech switch and an XT30 connector. The reason I'm using the XT30 connector is because that's what my battery uses, and I didn't want to change the battery. Now, you want to run your battery direct to the top of the FingerTech switch, and the reason for that is that you reduce arcing by doing it that way. So I just soldered the wire, added a little bit of heat shrink, add a little bit more heat shrink, and then soldered the end of the battery connector, tinning it first. Let's see if I can do this. Yep, there we go. Nice, good connection. Go ahead and close it up with the heat shrink. And now I'm going to attach the positive wire on the DESC with the positive lead on the brushless ESC. So I'm going to twist those together, add a little bit of heat shrink, and tin the wires, trim it, make sure it's nice and straight, and then tin the pad on the switch and connect them. Add a little bit more solder there and make the joint nice and good. And push the heat shrink up. Tighten that down. And that's the positive lead done. So now I'm going to do the exact same thing with the ground lead. Just twist them together. A little bit of heat shrink. Tin and trim the wire. Tin the battery side. Run those together. Another good strong connection. And then run the heat shrink up and seal it off. So now I'm down to the motor leads. Now with the motor leads, I'm going to make sure that they're about the same length. Strip off the ends, tin them, and attach them to the DESC. Now at this point, I don't know which way is which. When you have the DESC pointed up and down, the left side should be to the left motor and the right side should be to the right motor, which is as I'm wiring it now. The only thing that I'm not sure about is which side is forward and which side is backwards. And there's an easy way to test for that. And so I just, as you can see, I just put it up on top of a block. I got my battery, connect the battery, and then I got my radio, turn my radio on, turn the robot on, and I put, when I push the stick forward, the left motor should go forward. And when I push the stick to the left, the right motor should go forward. And of course I got it backwards, so I'm just gonna swap these here, and now I should be good once I get this last lead soldered. Trim it up a little bit, and there we go. I'll just test it, make sure, and now I calibrate and it's good. And so now the last little bit we have to do for wiring is to attach the switch and wire the power LED. So go ahead and run the 440 screw into the side of the switch, making sure that the screw for the switch is pointed up, and then run the other one in, and then you can tighten both of them. On to mounting the power LED. So first I put the power LED into its hole, push the leads down, route it over to where the DESC is, trim the wires, go ahead and tin the ends. And now on this model, there's some big exposed pads, so I'm just going to attach it to the positive and negative pad for the 5 volts. And that's good to go. This leads us to the last part, which is mounting the weapon hub. So go ahead and put the fiberglass spacer down first, which I give you a couple extras, and then screw in the aluminum spacer. Now, I've already got the bearing pressed in on this one, but when you press the bearing in, you want to push it down on a table or a hard surface and make sure that the narrow end is all the way flush and that the bottom end has a little bit of bearing sticking out. And then you're going to line up. There's a notch on either side of the hub, and that's the hole where the safety key can go through. And I like to line it up so that the blade is lined up with those north and south, so that when you put the safety key in, the half of the blade is inside the robot and the other half is sticking out. And the reason I do it that way is that if you have to have safety covers or if you make your blade really sharp, you can only have to make covers for one half. But you can mount it any way you want. The whole pattern is symmetrical, so you can rotate it any which way. So go ahead and run the 1032 screws in, and then we're going to mount up the belt. So when you attach the belt, you want to make sure that the small side goes around the flange, and then the large pulley, and then you just set it down. You want to check to make sure you're not binding anywhere. If you are, you probably need to adjust the pulley on the top. And then go ahead and add the battery in. It'll fit a couple different ways. You just have to kind of figure out what works best for you. And then install the top panel, making sure that the hole for the switch is on the same side as the switch. So I'm going to go ahead and run the center screws in, and then I'm going to put the large screw in and make sure that everything still spins freely. Because sometimes when you tighten everything down, you might need to add a second spacer and just take the two Allen keys and make sure it's tight. Check to make sure the safety key fits. And then we're going to go ahead and run the rest of the screws in. Now before we get to testing, I want to take a moment to talk to you guys about safety. Yeah, safety. You know, a lot of people have a real cavalier attitude towards it. You know, oh, this robot's not going to hurt me. But let me tell you guys, these things have some serious power. Even the small ones. Even the fairy weights. You know, an 1806 motor spinning a 3-inch diameter disc is still going to bite you. And it's going to hurt. Don't do it. You know, only test inside of an arena that's capable of stopping the robot that you build. And if you're not sure if you've got an arena that's safe enough, ask the community. It's not worth getting hurt. It really isn't. So with that said, I've got this test box here. This is 3/4-inch plywood all the way around. And it's a little small, but it'll suit our purposes for testing vector spin-up. And it's got a 3/8-inch Lexan sheet of plastic on top so you can see what's going on. So let's get started. So my test arena is just a box with a 3/8 lid and a couple of steel bumpers because I break things. So now what I'm going to do, so I'm going to take my radio, turn my radio on, make sure my stick is down, set that aside, and here it powered on. I'm just going to check, I have signal. Pull the pin out, close, and lock. So you can see, I just got a little lock, so this lid can't come up. And now, my box is very small, but I don't have a lot of space, so if you want to build a bigger box, go right ahead and do a spin-up test. So as you can hear, everything sounds pretty good. Try not to hit the inside of my box any more than I already have. I'm going to go ahead and do a full power spin-up test. I'll probably bounce off the inside of my box, but I'm going to try anyways. And there you have it. Now, when you're done,
all you do. Turn it off. Pop the pin in. And you're good to go. So now that you've completed Vector, I have a couple of tips and tricks for you. The first is, before every match, make sure you check all the screws to make sure they're tight, especially the center one. Now, the way that I do this is you take the two keys and you make sure that they're both in there, and then you tighten and pull as hard as you can. Make sure that that's tight. This will work loose on you, so you want to make sure that you tighten them before every match. If you go a couple of matches without tightening them, the screws will work out, or if you don't have it in there really tight, you can Loctite them. Just make sure you use a compound that's not one of the super tight compounds, green or blue, probably blue for that. All the other screws tend to stay put, but you want to check these as well, make sure that they're nice and tight. Snug these up. And that's about it. If you have any questions, make sure to either post on our forum, forum.endbots.com, or you can contact us at sales@endbots.com. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe, and thank you for watching.